Okay, I got muted. Can everybody hear me? Awesome. Okay, so we plan to start this engagement talking about 211. We felt it's a really good starting place to kind of move through that circle. So for those of you who don't know, 211 hosts the most comprehensive health and human services database in Dane County. The hotline can connect callers with thousands of nonprofit and government services in their area. And we partner with 211 call centers in Wisconsin to maintain a really cohesive statewide system. When somebody calls 211, they can get connected with confidential and trained service providers who can help locate resources and give them referrals for programs and assistance. We know that if a person has one need, they likely have many other needs that they're working through, and navigating through all the different resources available in the community can be really tough. But 211 helps folks find the resources they need in the most efficient and comprehensive manner. Someone could call 211 and get help finding food pantries, rent assistance, childcare, transportation, all just from one call. Individuals and families can connect with 211 resources through phone calls, text messages, online chats, and online searching. Last year, 211 saw an influx in call volume due to the pandemic. As people in our community found themselves losing their jobs, struggling to pay rent and utility bills, scrambling to find food to feed their families, they turned to 211 for help. In March of 2020, we saw nearly 100% increase in the number of calls coming in, and the call volume continued to sit well above the average for the remainder of the year. People called 211 to get help finding food pantries, applying for unemployment benefits, accessing COVID-19 resources, finding rent and utility assistance, and many more things. So we wanted to have everyone kind of experience what a call kind of looks like and sounds like. And we wanted to take some time to let you guys see for yourselves how many different resources are available to find through 211. So we're going to play a reenactment of a real call that was made to 211 last year. And we pulled out just a few pieces where the caller was kind of talking about their needs and what they needed help with. So keep track of the different needs that you hear, and we'll do a little activity afterwards.
Hi, I need to file an appeal for unemployment.
Okay, sure.
Yeah, I don't know why I didn't get accepted or anything, but I don't know how this works. So I've never done this before, but I'm basically like freaking out because I can't afford to feed my kids right now. So, yeah.
Well, I have food stamps and, I'm in Badger Care, but I could use some help with like other food. Also, my electricity is about to get shut off. So that's insane. It's like everything is just happening all at once. I don't know what to do. I'm sorry. Aww. Sorry, I'm so upset. It's just really difficult.
All right. So Derek is going to go ahead and post this link in the chat. This is the link to the guided search on 211. So if you missed them, these were the three things that the caller needed help with. And using the guided search feature on 211, take a few moments to search for resources that could help the caller with these three things: unemployment, food, and utility payments. We'll give everyone a few minutes to click around. Feel free to turn your camera off and focus on searching, and we'll bring everyone back in just a few moments.
Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Instead of me, always seems to know the way. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. I just one look at you. get you. And I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
Doing? Did everyone have some time to take a peek at the website? Take that as a yes. Okay, so let's share out a little bit. What resources did you guys find to help the caller with unemployment? What things did you find on the website? Feel free to unmute and share or throw what you're thinking in the chat.
I guess I went straight for food. I think I heard her talk about the babies, her not being able to feed her. First, I had to stop crying. First, I had to stop myself from crying. Then I had to make sure I wasn't crying. And then I had to start looking. And I looked for food first, considering that the babies couldn't have food. So I looked for that. And then I think some people said they looked for, Michaela said she found the unemployment clinic for a pill. And Molly said legal assistance to help out.
Yeah. Yeah. And let's open it up for any three of these needs. What did you guys find? Anyone find anything for utility assistance, utility payments?
Quiet group today.
Well, if you didn't find it, it's there. There's a whole utility help section. But was there anything else that, yeah, Michaela said the DIGS program. Yeah, thanks, Molly. As you kind of took time to click around, was there anything else that surprised you? Anything else that was interesting? Did you find maybe a category of assistance that you maybe didn't expect to see? Thanks, Jody and Kristen. I know when I was clicking around, legal assistance was one that I didn't necessarily expect to see. Same thing with clothing. Like that seems like a very basic need, and yet there's a whole category for it. But as you can see, there's a very wide variety of help that 211 can provide for people. Someone can call 211 and find agencies and programs to help them with many different types and degrees of needs. Each of these needs that you see in the screen ultimately are kind of related, but finding resources to solve them all without 211 would require somebody to contact three different sources, if not more. So this also gives us an idea of what some of the needs are in the community and shows us that they're very diverse and very plentiful. Looking forward, we know that there's going to be a lot of work necessary to help our community recover long-term from the pandemic. 211 has reported that some of the top requests for assistance in Dane County so far this year include housing and shelter, healthcare and COVID-19 related assistance, and food. 211 helps individuals and families in our community find the vital resources that they need to survive. And this year, as we approach our centennial, we're working really hard to endow the 211 resource. If we can achieve this, 211 will always be available for anyone to use to get help, regardless of how the campaign goes and what programs are funded. So we help host this 2-1-1 hotline so people can find agencies to help with their needs, but we also fund the agencies that 2-1-1 connects with the people in our community. Each year we receive requests for funding from a multitude of very credible, very important agencies and their programs. And each year we're tasked with the challenge of making really tough choices about which programs to fund. So here are two examples of the requests that we may see. We're moving into the next part of this engagement, kind of talking about the investment process. And in a perfect world, we would have, you know, a video here kind of going through different pitches and different requests for funding that we would receive. But for today's sake and time's sake, Derek and I are going to act as the agency representatives and pitch our agencies. So I'm going to hand it over to Derek to tell us about Agency A.
Yeah, so bear with me as I struggle through this. Imagine that United Way is in possession of this like $5,000 to decide whether we're going to give that money to Agency A or Agency B. My program, Agency A, helps to integrate reading into pediatric practices. So we advise families about the importance of reading with children and hope to share those books and use them as a catalyst for healthy childhood development. Last year, we were able to serve 152,000 children in Wisconsin. The $5,000 would help us to provide up to 2,000 books for well-child visits at an average cost of $250 a book, as opposed to Peyton's Agency B.
Yep, so Agency B, our program provides housing-related emergency assistance to individuals and families in Dane County who are facing eviction and are at risk of becoming homeless. Last year, 700 households in our community experiencing a crisis affecting their housing stability were able to stay in their homes because of our program. $5,000 could help us provide 12 grants of housing assistance that will help prevent eviction and homelessness for a household that month. So letting that sink in a little bit and assuming you have $5,000 to spend, which agency do you fund? Think about which reaches more people, which has the greatest impact. Think about which has the greatest impact long-term. Feel free to unmute and share what you're thinking or throw it in the chat as well.
I see a lot of B's in the chat. Would anyone like to explain why they might invest in Agency B over Agency A?
Hi, this is Candace. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Hi, Candace. Thanks.
Okay. Hey. I chose Agency B just because, you know, homelessness is, it's kind of like you've been speaking to, it's not just one problem. When a family is homeless, that's probably a compounding number of issues. And, you know, I just felt that keeping a family and children in their home, although child wellness and Agency A is very, very important as well. If I had to choose, I felt that homelessness or having a home is kind of the basis for being able to grow and have wellness in other areas. Just my thought.
Yeah, thank you for sharing. Mm-hmm.
Anyone have thoughts on A?
I'm driving, so I'm not sure if you guys can hear me.
Yes, we can.
I didn't want to miss this meeting, but I had to drive home. So, you guys were describing the agencies, I was all in for Agency A, and then I heard the description of Agency B, and then I changed my mind because I think that Agency B, by helping people stay in their homes, it has a ripple effect, and it not only affects their housing, but it affects all of the education and kids staying in school and being able to stay with their families as a unit. And, you know, and then those other things like education and reading and that can come after. So that's kind of the way I felt.
Thanks for sharing.
Yeah, Agency B is definitely like a more basic need than, Agency A, despite the different reach of each program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what it all comes down to is, although this decision may have been a little easier, making funding decisions between agencies is not really easy. How do you choose between two very credible and successful programs? And I mean, how would you say no to Agency A? So United Way has a group of volunteers called the Vision Council, and it consists of community leaders, experts in education, income and health, people with real lived experiences. And these people, they review all the requests, they read all the proposals and research the programs and agencies and ultimately make a recommendation on who and what programs to fund. Note that the data points on the screen here are simply placeholders until our most up-to-date reporting is complete. But last time we ran the numbers, our partner agencies would need $40 million to scale up to the point of meeting the needs of those that they serve in the community. In 2020, our campaign raised $17.8 million. Although we're incredibly proud of what we were able to accomplish last year, especially through the pandemic, it's obvious that we have a lot of work to do. There's a very large gap between what we are able to provide and what our partner agencies and the community needs. I'm gonna hand it over to Steve.
Thanks, Peyton. So at this point, we kind of wrap up this little engagement with a really awesome video from Renee or the campaign chairs, or if your company CEOs or other leaders at your company would wanna make a direct appeal to place that right here. So kind of, we hope that you saw kind of the train of thought we were attempting to get at, and this is why we really need your feedback, but showing the needs in the community, showing how 2-1-1 is connecting people to the resources, showing that we are investing in programs that are making measurable change, but we don't have enough to make to scale up and really make the change that we need in the community. So we would pinnacle all of that in this video with the message of, we need your help to make this possible. We need your help to make Dane County a place where everyone can succeed in schoolwork and life from a very passionate leader in our community. So that being said, those were, like I said at the beginning, just two of the kind of choose your own adventure facilitated engagements that we have. We're working on some for program participants. So listening in on individuals with lived experience and how they kind of guide the work that we're doing. Some really cool things when it comes to businesses and the hire initiative and how business helps to guide some of the programs and create some of the programs and partner with us there. And then volunteer, we have a cool section on volunteerism, volunteertime.org. So seeing one of those 2-1-1 resources and finding a volunteer opportunity, say that I and a bunch of my friends wanted to go and help out to show how everything is kind of connected through United Way's work. That all being said, we would love your feedback now on what you feel worked for these two little sections, maybe where we could improve. So opening the floor, hope you all have some opinions and insight. And I'm not above calling on people because I can see all your names.
I can share one from the perspective of trying to lead the conversation a little bit. So when we are talking through the investment process, do you guys feel it would be more beneficial So between Agency A and Agency B, what we're really trying to show is how tough making funding decisions is. And it seems like it was a pretty easy decision for you all based on the two examples we used. Would you guys think it'd be more beneficial maybe to switch it up and have two different examples, maybe one with a tougher decision involved?
Yeah, I think it, you know, like you said, if maybe there was a tougher decision, I think it'd be interesting to get those other unique perspectives on maybe both sides. And I think you could maybe almost engage more conversation that way as well, because people will kind of, I think people will kind of have their own opinions, and when it's really on the fence like that, can really get people's opinions kind of going and wanting them wanting to talk and share their perspective.
It's a really good, really, really good point. I think that's definitely something we're going to take into consideration. Thank you. What about
the... I have a thought.
Go ahead.
Hi, sorry. I was just thinking that the 211 call in examples or the recreation that you played really kind of tugged more on the heartstrings and would lead, I think, anyone when it comes to like giving books to children, which is obviously important, but then also like focusing on the quality of life and housing. I feel like it's almost, I don't know, kind of leading you down that path. So I feel like maybe if that call was presented at a different time, it wouldn't kind of lead everyone to go with Agency B.
That's a really good point too. And that call really did end on a really, really sad note. So really good point.
In general, do you think this format, I mean, do you think your colleagues, coworkers would get something out of this? Would this be worth the time to kind of have a meeting around or replace a kickoff?
I'll jump in and hopefully you guys can hear me okay. I think these are really interesting. I think these are different messages than we typically use to talk about United Way. I think the challenge of deciding who gets funding is something that people don't necessarily think about. So I think that's a really great point. And I think, you know, the 211 call I think is great. I've been doing campaigns for quite a while now, and I feel like this is something different that I can talk about. You know, I loved the explanation too of the Vision Council, because I think it can be kind of mysterious as to how does United Way, you know, unless you dig in and look at the website, how do they choose who gets funding? And I think that is a really important piece, is who's making these decisions and who's at the table. I think that's great to share with people. So I really like them both, or all of them, yes.
Thank you. Logistics-wise, thinking back to the 211 exercise, logistically, how did that work with like clicking onto the guided search and clicking on the website? Did that feel meaningful? Did that just like stress you out, or was it annoying? Like, be honest, what was your experience with that?
I thought it was great because it gave you an idea of what all, kind of like you guys were alerting to, is like what other options are out there. And, you know, yes, you think about people needing homes, about them having income issues, but there are a lot of other things on there that you know, can really be a cause for issue with families. So I thought it was great that it had all of those categories. It was really easy to navigate. And yeah, it just provided so many different options for you to be able to click on and kind of just work through yourself. I thought it was great. I think we will definitely use that, as a tool in some manner.
What else might you want to see?
Did the slide in regard to, I guess, how many organizations, I guess, did it say how many organizations you kind of have, or you think about, or have the option of funding? I couldn't remember, and I didn't know. That might be quite I don't know, that might be kind of mind-blowing to hear about all of the different organizations that could use our help. And not only do we have to pick between one or two, but man, we have all of these that request our help, and really we can only come down to so many that we're able to fund. But just a thought on that.
That's a great idea. I think that'd be very impactful.
Any thoughts on, was it surprising that $40 million that we would need to scale the work versus us only being able to raise 17.8 in any given years?
I think context is always valuable when you can share it. I think, you know, giving everyone the idea of what the big picture is and what the need really is, really puts it in context. And I think that's always helpful. So I liked that statistic. I thought it was really good.
I thought it was really good too. And for me, I thought, well, what's going to happen with the difference? I mean, there's such a huge difference. Does that mean that they're not going to be able to have their programs? Where's the other funding coming from? So I really like that.
Yeah, I was just going to add too, when I see 17 million, I think, wow, that's a huge number. Like, that's awesome. But then when you have that 40 million, then it's very eye-opening to think of how much more we need to go and how much more we need to give and the impact out there that we can make. So I think comparing both of those numbers, 17 million is a lot of money, but 40 million is where we can be at with the collective effort.
Yep.
Yeah, maybe we can provide more context. So instead of just saying scaling up, really what that means is these agencies, partner agencies, these programs, they know the families, they know the individuals that you know, they could work with, and they just don't have the capacity to do so. So maybe combining that with the 40 million to show what that could do would help land the plane.
Yeah, I'd like that.
Just to add to that, I was on a call with a nonprofit and they were talking about how many families were in their waiting for assistance, kind of on their wait list. And that really makes you feel like the sense of urgency and like there's this huge need. And yeah, you can feel the frustration of the nonprofit, you know, employees just saying like, there's a ton of need. We just can't reach it. So that was a statistic that was just shared with me this week and really was impactful. So kind of piggybacking on that, I think, again, context always useful.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, I like that. I think showing like not nonprofits and agencies, they're ready, like they're very ready to go and help people, but they're held back financially. So it's a great idea.
You know, I was just thinking it might be nice to have something that, you know, says, you know, if we raise this $40 million, then we'd be able to help, you know, 2,300 more families, I don't know, give lunches to their kids every day or whatever. You know, some of those kind of statistics might be helpful too.
Love that. Any kind of closing thoughts on this before moving to our next section? Awesome. Thank you for that feedback.
Moving on here. The next tool that we wanted to share with you guys is something new this year. We know that creating and facilitating special events can be arguably one of the most fun parts of a campaign, but also one of the most challenging parts of having a campaign. So we reached out to ECMs just like you guys that have all helped their companies host wonderful special events and asked them to share all the details. So we took all of these, we compiled the details and their tips and tricks and secrets and best practices, and are gonna have them all in one place where you can browse and get ideas. So we have kind of a version ready to show you, still kind of in the works, but we wanted to show it to you guys today. Let me bring it over here. So it's going to live on this, whoops, hang on. Okay, so the special event recipe book will live on the campaign tools website, which some of you may be familiar with. If not, this is just a website where we have all kinds of resources and tools and things to help with your campaign. And don't worry, we'll provide all the links in the chat and after in a follow-up email as well. But it's going to live on this page, and you'll be able to see all of the special events listed here. So you will be able to browse different events. You also can see all of them by clicking the download all button. And this is kind of what they're going to look like. So you can see here, WPS shared their bingo event with us. And it's just going to have all kinds of details that you can use to help recreate this for your own. They shared their suggested donation amount, how successful they were, resources that they used, instructions, some of their best practices, and even sample communications. So our wonderful marketing team is working really hard on getting all the campaign materials ready. So they're just about finished with this, but all of them are going to be uploaded here. And I can show you, these are all of the events we have compiled so far. So plenty to choose from. That said, if you have an event from a past campaign that was really successful or you had a lot of fun with, feel free to email me and we'll make sure we get all the details and we can get it up on the website so other ECMs can learn from you guys and we all can kind of help each other. That's the quick overview of the special event recipe book. What are your guys' thoughts? Is this helpful? Is there something different you would like to see? Fire away. Very helpful. Good. Glad to hear it. What's the most challenging part of putting special events together for you guys? Like what's really challenging?
I think for us at UW Credit Union, it's more getting the word out and participation, like making sure that there's events for people that, you know, maybe we'll do some in-person events and people, you know, really want that compared to you balancing out with virtual events too.
Awesome. Yeah, I think that's a struggle we're going to encounter this year is this awkward hybrid model. Like it's one thing to have them all in person or another to have them all virtual, but then this awkward, like how do we cater to everyone and how do we make this work?
Yeah. Can I ask how many of you are anticipating being virtual versus hybrid versus in person?
$1 million question. hybrid. Oh boy, lots of hybrids.
So a lot of the hybrid being the case, do you see United Way special events and just things like that as an opportunity for more of those in-person interactions or maybe less so, kind of stick to the online element for that?
I think people just don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I think we will definitely use, and we've already been talking about events and ways we can use United Way events to kind of capitalize on all of our employees' urge probably to go out and see people and to be together and get outside. And so, yeah, we're hoping to really leverage, I guess, that people's kind of feeling of being cooped up. So that's our thought.
Sounds like the confidence is there. People really want to get out. They just probably are apprehensive about jumping off the diving board, but we want to go deep. I was going to ask a follow-up question to you, yours, Peyton. For those of us who did have successful events last year, since we're kind of still in this hybrid space, were there any events over the computer virtually that really like kind of knocked the cover off the ball? Things that you felt, or one thing that you may have saw in another meeting or some other organization virtual events that you participated in, something that you saw that was really unique? I saw mine on there. I saw it's like trivia is always cool, like online Jeopardy. Mm-hmm. But I never saw the Masked Singer. I always would pick Steve. I would always think it's Steve behind the mask. Anything else that really stood out for you guys?
I'll share one thing. So my name is Candace, by the way, and I am with John Deere Financial out of Madison. So last year we did a series of, I don't know if it was a series, I know we did two or three videos, and we tried to do them, in a fun way. Some of them were very funny. Some of them more serious, but we had a lot of people actually that watched those videos. Although again, it wasn't an event, it wasn't, maybe in itself, it wasn't a fundraiser, but we had so many people watch those videos. We were very surprised that we had that kind of viewing. Something I recommend, I guess, get people interested in noticing United Way and your campaign and the events that you're doing. It was really fun. And yeah, we just had a lot of people that liked them. So.
At UW Credit Union, we did the Masked Singer, which turned out really successful. But then the other one we did was a virtual run. So that one, there was a lot of participation, and then we had like a board and people could participate with, their numbers or when they completed it. So I can see it this year being more hybrid. So maybe there's like an in-person, 5K, and then we could do virtual still too.
That's a good point. I had a few conversations with companies last year who had thought about doing a virtual 5K, but they were like, we just don't know how to incentivize people to do it on their own, because doing a 5K, that's the fun part, is doing it in person. So I think maybe this year with that hybrid model, it'd be really great for companies who wanted to do it last year. Awesome. Well, like I said, if you guys have any other ideas or special events you did before that were really, really fun and successful, feel free to shoot me an email and we can get it added to the special event recipe book. Moving into the last part here, I gotta get my screen back up. We want to share just a few upcoming events and opportunities and things happening. Derek put in the chat our events calendar on the website. So that's a great place to look for updates on events. Most of these things we also normally put in the ECM newsletter. All links and dates are also going to be provided in a follow-up email too. So, going through some of these, Seasons of Caring, Days of Action. If you're not familiar with that, Seasons of Caring is something we do to kind of promote volunteering, and volunteeryourtime.org is a website we run where there's just tons of different volunteer opportunities. So starting tomorrow through this weekend, there's a lot of new opportunities to volunteer and get involved. Women United Speed Mentoring coming up in July. This is a really cool chance to connect with and learn from some really successful women leaders in our community. There's going to be breakout sessions where you can get to know these. I think they have 5 people coming. Get to know these women and learn from them and connect with them and chat. So that's going to be a really good time. Another round of Seasons of Caring in July. Steve, tell us about the next Link event.
Yeah, and just for all of you, Link is United Way's Young Professional Group. No age requirement. No, well, 21, we usually go to bars, but, you know, we're not going to check. And then no donation requirement. So open to everybody, as inclusive as we can. We try to put on fun philanthropy parties, you know, just trying to make a good experience and put a little bit of that community awareness into it as well. So we are hosting our third annual Bags and Brews benefit. So Bags or Cornhole. It's a tournament. It's going to be at Ale Asylum, essentially. So it's $20 to enter. That is the donation pot. Excuse me. Every game you win is $5 donation. You get to choose if it goes to education, income, or health. And then the winner gets to decide the other half of the pot, where that goes. So trying to infuse that, like, knowledge, education with a fun event as well. Back to you.
Thank you. Very exciting. Next on the list is our 2021 campaign think tank. For anyone who isn't familiar with the think tank or the campaign team workshop, it's a time when we all kind of come together, staff and ECMs, and we spend a morning just kind of going over new campaign tools, learning about different ways that we can host a really good campaign. We want to make sure we give you guys everything that you need, get to learn from staff, connect with other ECMs, and really just kind of get everyone ready for campaign season and make sure everyone's feeling good about it. So if you're a new ECM, this is a really, really great opportunity to kind of get accustomed to the campaign and learn a few things as you dive into it. So mark your calendars for that. We also have our community kickoff planned for August 17th. More details to come on that. Checking back on the events calendar is going to be the best place for that. But that's kind of when we just kick off the whole campaign. Yeah, so that's coming up. Another link event in August, which I'll have Steve talk about.
A golf outing. It's going to be a scramble. So we're also looking for sponsors. So whole sponsors, $250 to $500. That is a direct donation to United Way. So I think we can, on the back end, even have that credited to your campaign. I'll have to look into that a little bit more and get back to everybody. But August 28th, foursomes, it's going to be a blast.
Awesome. September 10th, we have the Women United Breakfast. There's going to be both virtual and in-person options, if I can remember correctly, but that happens every year. It's a pretty cool thing. And then heading into later in the year, in November, we really are hoping to have a community-wide silent auction. So we're still kind of in planning mode for this. We have a lot of really great ideas. Essentially, it's going to be a virtual silent auction that anyone and everyone can bid in. And we're really going to reach out to all of you guys to ask your companies if they'd be willing to donate something to be auctioned off. So it can be products and services that your company kind of specializes in. It can be gift cards or event tickets or really anything. But the really nice thing about this silent auction is any of the funds raised from the items that your company donates will get directly credited back to your special event total for 2021. So this is a really, really great opportunity to boost that those special event dollars and help boost your campaigns as well. So more to come on that. If you feel like you would, your company would be willing to donate something, you can reach out to us. I'll make sure to include that in a follow-up email here, but start thinking about that and start thinking about if your company would like to contribute and participate. Does anyone have any questions on upcoming opportunities and events? I know it's a lot. We're just very busy people. Awesome. We've got one more thing to cover here. I'm going to hand it over to Steve.
So next year, 2022, is our centennial celebration. We're working on a lot of fun things for that year, year round. One of the things, though, we are giving out these community builder awards. So any company, individual who has kind of contributed to making our community a better place, we are inviting them to apply, nominate somebody else that you think would be a great award recipient. And we just want to highlight the decades and decades and decades, the last 100 years of work that y'all have been doing in the community to make it the best place to live. So check that link if you're interested to learn more. Just going to note the deadline is September 1st for that of this year. Back to you, Peyton.
Yeah, sorry, I was trying to unmute. All right, well, that's kind of what we had for you guys today. Do you have any final thoughts, anything that came to mind as we were finishing up about the two tools that we showed you? Anything else? We really appreciate you guys joining on today. Like Steve said in the beginning, we really lean on your guys' feedback for planning, and we want to make sure that your guys' campaigns are obviously successful but meaningful to all of you and your staff as well. Awesome. Well, if nobody has any other questions or any other thoughts that they wanted to bring up, we can let you go. I hope you guys had a good time. I think we learned a lot. We have a lot of work to do.